not really easy thing. When I think about inspiring people, I think about the tone of the voice, the volume of the voice, power of the voice, also an art of persuasion. But I'm sure that there are some other factors which are very important, which may give us success if we want to really inspire other people. But it's not really thing. It is not really easy thing. Today, Roy will present to us his speech, and he will tell us what Toastmasters has done for him. Let's check whether it will be inspiring.
So basically I'm going to take you on a little journey of when I was younger, to who I was, to who I am today. When I was very young, I wouldn't go into the shop. I'd give my friend the money because I was too shy to go into the shop. I remember when I was 18, when we went to the pub, when I started drinking, I was a good boy, I waited till I was 18 to start drinking. I would give my friend the money because I actually was too nervous going up to the bar ordering the drinks. I remember being in school and the teacher would go around and make people stand up and actually repeat the history lesson or whatever we had to do. And I was actually so nervous, my voice would quiver and like just hated it. And like he used to give us lessons, and the same guy was actually a very bad teacher. He was very aggressive and he'd be shouting at you. So despite actually studying a lot, I would spend an hour or more practicing and everything, I would just go blank when I was there. And we had an exam, an end of year exam, and I got 18%. And in front of the whole class, he said, my grandmother would do better, and she's been dead 10 years. And I laugh at it, no. But you can imagine at 13 years of age what that actually does to you. Later, I had a different history teacher who actually was really calm, really nice. I totally respected him. And I was getting 100%. And it just shows what the difference a person can do to you. So I went to university and I done a project. I done a diploma in applied project management. I've done different courses. And one of the courses that I actually done, we had to do a presentation. I had done everything because the topic I'd done was about a band. My brother was in a band, so I just got all the information from him and created the project. I'd done basically everything. The presentation, the other guy that I was partnered with, he got way better. Mark than me, even though I'd done 90% of the work because he basically presented well, and I just was so nervous that kind of my brain was kind of sizzling up. When I was working for a very large mechanical contractor. We were doing projects for like over 10 million, just our side, I think, 10 million euro. And I could be sitting in a room with 20 or 30 people, the client for Johnson & Johnson, architects, builders, and it was the worst part of my week. I was very competent to what I'd done in jobs. I was making a lot of money for the company, but I just hated it. My voice just go. It was the worst part, and I used to just wait for it to be actually ended. So that was my kind of journey to, you know, speaking, public speaking and everything, how I was. I joined a Toastmasters in Ireland and I'd done about 6 speeches. And I remember, like, I used to have the notes, I used to have the notes in front of me. I remember being so nervous that it's just, I used to be practicing, and I just get blank. And I didn't feel right. It just didn't feel right to me. I actually didn't enjoy it. I was the best man to my friend's wedding. He was, which is an honor in most countries, so it was actually, and there was about 150 people. So I presented the actual speech and practiced it umpteen times. I tried to do it in front of my mother, but my mother is kind of a joker, so when I done it in front of her, she just started laughing, so I knew I couldn't do it to that. So I went to my grandmother, and basically my grandmother said, why are you doing that? So that was one lesson that I got from my grandmother, and that helped me. But what happened during the wedding is I done the speech, all was grand, and then I actually disappeared. I didn't drink beforehand, I disappeared, and I had a few drinks at the bar to just calm my nerves afterwards, and I didn't realize what they do when there's a wedding in Ireland. The bride and groom dance, but then afterwards they look for the best man and the best and the groomed to actual dance, and I was nowhere to be found. So if I look at my family and where this shyness and nervousness came from, I can see it came from my great grandmother, and I've been very lucky that my great grandmother was alive till I was 12, and I know her very well, beautiful lady. But since she was 30, she lived till 86, she didn't come outside of the house. She only came outside of the house twice to get her pension and eventually signed it over for her daughter to be able to collect it for. She was so shy that coming outside of the house, so you can imagine living your whole life inside of the house. Her granddaughter, so my grandmother was kind of different. She didn't have the shyness, but she moved to the UK during the war and everything. So, but my mother was kind of brought up by my great-grandmother, so she kind of had it as well. She was shy. When visitors would come, they'd go upstairs and wouldn't talk to the visitors. And my mother actually, she'd done a course in the university in Ireland when she was about 50, and she was saying that they had to, for part of the project, they had to have a debate. And when she finished, the other person spoke first, and she basically said, "I'm very sorry, but I'm so nervous, I heard nothing he said." And I can relate to that, I understand that. And it's like, now we do the word of the day, I can totally relax and I enjoy that. But I remember, you come across situations like that where they're going around the room, what you do or whatever. For me, over the last few years, what used to happen is that I used to be so nervous and thinking about what's going to happen. I wouldn't hear the two or three people before me. I just go into panic mode. And I know that a few other people have told me the exact same thing happened. And basically, I'm here to tell you that you should stop doing that, because even say these meetings or anything afterwards, if you think people are talking about you or how you spoke or what you said, it's the last thing they're thinking about. The only person that's actually thinking about it and worrying about it is yourself. So the first thing you should do is actually stop worrying about that. What I've actually done is with my daughter, and I do it with my son as well, like my daughter's 17 now, so when she was young, when I bring her to the shop, I'd say, "You get the stuff." And she goes, no, daddy. And I say, "No." And I just constantly, or if she wanted to change something or do anything, she always had to go. And I was just basically making her not to be nervous, to constantly be in contact with people. And I can see she's now very confident in what she does. So it actually definitely helps. What I have here through my journey with Toastmasters, these are the feedbacks that I get. I keep them because they mean so much to me. Basically, comments like, "You've got all the stuff in your pocket." I was like, okay. And since someone made me aware of that, then I don't do it anymore. I take my stuff out and put it into my bag. And if you see somebody that actually does the same, you realize that it does. It makes a difference not to have that. And there was another time I had a jacket and I was pulling the jacket. About 10 people saw that. I didn't realize it, but the fact that they made me aware of it, the constructive feedback has actually helped me in what I do. The other thing is the awards that I've got. They might seem simple, but they actually mean a lot to be kind of get the best speaker or table topics. They're stuff that I hold on to and I actually appreciate, and it makes a difference. There's some people, I've spoke to everybody here in detail and the other group, and a lot of people are afraid to take different roles. For example, evaluator, general evaluator, or Toastmaster. And I'm basically here to tell you that they're not difficult. It's just the fear is inside yourself. For example, the Toastmaster, what I've done is I brought what I actually do. So I basically say, you pick the team, so you talk about something that you're comfortable about. So for example, boxing. So basically you start, you make the team sport or something like that, and you can give us a story about that. And then you say, now I'll introduce you to the general evaluator, who will introduce you to the team. Then it comes back to you, you do question it. And I have not written down, I bring that with me. So that basically when, say you were the general evaluator, when you're up here, I'm looking at the next thing that I must do. And by just breaking it down into simple steps, I make the task very easy. So if anybody is interested in actually doing the Toastmaster position, I can share this with you, and I actually think it helps. The same with evaluator and actual general evaluator. There's little checklists, and by actually doing that, it helps you to progress. So for me, going forward with the speeches that I've done, I don't get nervous no more. I mean, sometimes people say, yeah, at the start or whatever, I noticed a bit of nervousness and everything. But from where I've been to where I am now, I think that it's because of Toastmasters that I have that. And I want to thank this community, and I plan to give back to the community, because if there wasn't people like Justina and Jacek, Thomas, everybody, to help me, I want to be able to help others to do the same thing.